Thank you very much, Matt, Jenny, Jeff, the whole SPAR family, and all of you. I could not be prouder and more humble to be here with you today. And I think I'll really echo some of the words you've already heard. We can and will make a difference. People in this room, you're making such a difference already. The video you saw in terms of the prison system, you know, it's amazing how much we're now in this movement that people are starting to realize that mental illness touches us all. Every single one of us, in one way or another, we're touched by mental illness. There should be absolutely no stigma or shame. You know, and we're rising up, we're tackling it on collectively as a society, and I'm absolutely convinced, like we've seen changes in our society over the last few years in other areas, we've got a long way to go, but working together, we're going to make a difference. And that's why I'm so proud and privileged to be able to work with organizations like PeaceLove, all of you, the Broadway Quartet, aka the PeaceLove Quartet, you know, aren't they amazing? So, you know, why are we here to get today? You know, it's to basically recognize that we've got a challenge in front of us, and yet we can do something about it. Why is there so much stigma and shame? And in my opinion, and you know, some people will say you're just this naive optimist. I think there's some bad people. There's some people who are just prejudiced, and there's nothing you can do about them. But most people, it's really about they don't know. There's ignorance, there's lack of awareness. And when there's things that you don't understand or seem mysterious, you kind of, I don't want to know about it, or that's just them, this is me, etc. And I think we can collectively help open people's eyes, educate them that these are just things that affect all of us. There's nothing to be scared of, there's nothing to sort of stigmatize people for, etc. And I think as we do that, we will see people join us and recognize that this is something that touches us all. So, you know, as you heard from Matt, I've been privileged to be in this space, and I really came in this space because during medical school, I unfortunately saw firsthand, you know, how much people suffer when they have these conditions, when you have bad depression, when you have bipolar disorder, where you have post-traumatic stress disorder, when you have schizophrenia, when you have someone who's suicidal. You just see how much pain and suffering and anguish it causes, not only for the person who's affected, but their whole surrounding, their families, their loved ones, and society. And so I realized that, you know, if I can help do something there, you know, what could be more rewarding than that? And then, unfortunately, I also realized, you know, there's almost a double whammy. It's the conditions themselves, which unfortunately affect so many of us. You've probably read the statistics, one in four of us, and sorry about the echo, one in four of us at some time will be touched by one of these illnesses. And then on top of that, to have stigma and shame that, you know, compounds things that should be unacceptable. And what's really horrible about stigma and shame is that sometimes it even prevents people from getting the treatment they deserve. And that's unacceptable. So that's why, you know, I got into this, we got into this. I trained in psychiatry and I trained in molecular and cellular biology to try and understand, you know, okay, what could be going on in these illnesses and what can we do about it? I was privileged to be at the National Institutes of Health for 15 years. I was the director of the Mood and Anxiety Disorders Program there. And then about 10 years ago, I joined J&J to see if we could both, you know, come up with new treatments, but then work collectively as a society to reduce stigma. You know, as I mentioned, ignorance, lack of awareness is one of those things, so let me take just a few minutes to tell you, you know, what we think we know about the brain. So, some people have said that the brain is the most complex thing in the galaxy, not in our body, but in the galaxy. And so it's not surprising that there's a hell of a lot we don't know. You know, we've got billions of these nerve cells that talk to each other and make sense of all this information. Our thinking, our emotions, our memory, our ability to experience pleasure, our ability to experience joy, sadness, all that, that somehow comes about from these millions of connections. So it's not surprising that it's this mysterious thing that people haven't quite understood, and so people say, I don't know what's going on there. One of the other things, you heard from some of the other people prior to me, these illnesses, or you know, when people are suffering from one of these conditions, it's not like a broken leg, or even something like diabetes or something like that, where people can kind of get it, or they can see that you've got a casting leg. this is a little bit more hidden. And so you've got this tendency to just sort of, you know, think, well, you know, what could it really be? And you get this platitudes, well, if you just exercised more, if you just, you know, meditated more, you just did this. And all those things are good. Of course they're good. But that doesn't really get to, you know, the fact that these are people who are suffering. So we need to really help people understand that. We've got a long way to go in terms of our understanding of the brain and the mind, but we really have learned a lot. And I'll just give you a few examples. So one is genes. So all of us, we carry all these genes that determine how tall you are, how, you know, skin color, whether you might be at risk for diabetes, whether you might be at risk for depression, hypertension, etc. But genes, most of these genes are not deterministic. And what that means is that they put you at a little bit of risk. So all of us carry some of these genes. Some of these genes might prefer high cholesterol, high blood pressure, depression, etc. But then genes and environment interact. And this is true of all illnesses. If you have hypertension, the environment, stress, etc., will make your blood pressure worse. It'll make your heart worse. Sorry. It'll make your asthma worse, you know. I've got to remember the mic. So that's not unusual. But what we're learning about is how do genes and environment interact. So you may well know that, unfortunately, in our society, often many people have had childhood abuse, sexual abuse, physical abuse, etc. And that, unfortunately, sometimes sets people on a trajectory to develop later illness, etc. How does that happen? How does something that happened here in childhood, 20 years later, put you at risk? And we've learned that it's something called epigenetics. So we all are born with these genes, but the genes get turned on or off depending on the environment. And one example would be exercising. If you work out, you turn on certain genes in your muscles that might allow you to run farther, you know, lift more weights, etc. The same things happen with our environment. You know, when you have these bad things that happen in your environment, it turns these genes on that can then, you know, put you at risk. But as I said, these things are not necessarily deterministic. They're probabilistic. And the good news there is that means you can do something about it. So, you know, with the right treatments, and treatments doesn't just mean medication. Treatment means medication. Treatment means resilience, as you heard from Sandy Taylor. Treatment means psychotherapy, art, communicating, all those things. You can actually kind of undo some of these effects. So that's one of the things we've learned about. One of the big things we've learned about is this area we call synaptic plasticity. And what the hell does synaptic plasticity mean? And, you know, you'll read many definitions, but one good way I like to communicate it is that all of you here, you're going to remember, you know, we were at this Peace Love event. We heard from the Broadway quartet. We heard from Matt. We heard from Jeff. We heard from Husseini, etc. You may not remember every detail, but a year from now you'll remember it. It's because our brains are what we call plastic. Your brains are actually changing as we speak to make this information relatively permanent. And now one of the reasons we're excited about that is recently we've capitalized on that to try and come up with treatments for depression that can treat severe suicidal depression in hours rather than weeks. And we think we've done that. So, you know, it used to be that you had to think, okay, you take this antidepressant, you wait 4 to 8 weeks, and if that doesn't work, then you try its next one, and you know, why should that be? So we think by hitting these plasticity pathways, you can do that. So there's a lot of these advances that are taking place, and I'm absolutely convinced that the more we can, you know, make these advances, we will educate society, and we'll start to do something about the stigma. But we can't wait. We got to do something here and now. So we got to get people to understand. And as you heard from Jeff and Matt, you know, in Davos at the World Economic Forum, you know, why does the World Economic Forum care about these illnesses? They care about these, and wow, I've been rambling longer than I thought. I got the 3 minutes on. You know, the World Economic Forum cares about this because these things touch every facet of our lives. It affects our relationships, our ability to go to school, our ability to work and be productive, etc. So people are coming together, and as I said, I think we're in the middle of a movement. Now, why art? I think art is very special. So art, in some ways, is what makes us human, our ability to express ourselves through these creative processes. You know, you go through the, you know, the books of history, and you can see so many artists, writers, poets, musicians who have actually been touched by mental illness. There's a special link between creativity and mental illness, and many people have found that art is a way to actually express yourself and communicate. And there may be something especially about language and expressing yourself in stories, either verbally or written, that is so powerful. You know, you heard from Matt, you heard from the video you saw about the prison system, etc. There's something that not only helps you to be able to express what you're going through, what you'd like, you know, where you'd like to be, etc., but it lets other people know you're not alone. You know, I'm like you. We've all been there. You know, the last song, or one of the songs you heard from Tandy Taylor as well, in terms of, you know, the hope and future, we can collectively instill that hope in each other, etc. And then the other thing, by expressing ourselves and expressing yourselves the way you do, you also really start to get away at stigma. Because unfortunately in our society, we've got this tendency to compartmentalize and say, that is a bipolar person. No, they're an individual who has a million characteristics. They also happen to have bipolar illness, just like many of us have hypertension, diabetes, etc., etc. They're not a bipolar person. And by expressing yourself as the whole caring, knowledgeable person you are, you can really communicate this and galvanize the movement. So we could not be prouder than to work with Peace, Love, and all of you. And I really feel confident that coming together as a society, we can and will make a big difference in this space. So thank you, thank you, thank you for everything you're doing. Thank you for having me here. And I could not be more grateful. Thank you again. Thank you.